I titled my message this morning, He Poured In the Oil and the Wine.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah. All right, we're going to get to reading. It says here, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through your name. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give in unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. Notwithstanding, in this rejoice not, that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. In that hour Jesus rejoiced in spirit and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent, and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in your sight, all things are delivered to me of my Father, and no man knows who the Son is but the Father, and who the Father is but the Son, and he to whom the Son will reveal him. And he turned him unto his disciples and said privately, Blessed are the eyes which see the things that you see. For I tell you that many prophets and kings have desired to see those things which you see and have not seen them, and to hear those things which you hear and have not heard them. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said unto him, What is written in the law? How readest thou? And he answering said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, You have answered right. This do, and you shall live. But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, And who is my neighbor? And Jesus answering said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment, meaning clothing, and wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him, and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him, and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow, or the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host of the inn, and said unto him, Take care of him, and whatsoever you spend more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Which now of these three thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, He that showed mercy on him. Then said Jesus unto him, Go and do thou likewise. Praise God. Well, I just want to invite everybody this morning to see a couple of old faces coming back. We've been praying, or at least I've been praying, that the Lord would send people back in from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Amen. And the Lord has been sending more and more people, and we're happy for that. So this morning, the overall context of what we're talking about here, if you go back and you read the whole chapter of chapter 10, Jesus has commissioned these 70 disciples, and he's told them to go out and to do the work of God. Amen. And essentially, they were told to journey throughout the land and to notify all the inhabitants of the kingdom. Now, we didn't read the whole chapter, but if you go back and you read it, what you would find out is that God, Jesus wants them to tell them that the kingdom of God has arrived. Now, I don't know if you know this or not, but God has slowly but surely been taking this earth back. You know, whenever God first created Adam and Eve, there was no sin, amen? And God began to, it was communing with Adam and Eve in the midst of the garden. And then whenever the fall took place, there was a separation that happened. A separation between God and his creation. A separation between God's presence and his creation. And slowly but surely, slowly according to man's time anyway, God has been taking back more and more of this earth that he created, amen, and ultimately one day Jesus is going to come back and he's going to rule and reign on the throne of David, hallelujah, and fulfillment will finally be complete. So he's going out there, but when, listen, God sent Jesus to the earth, the kingdom of God was resident on the inside of Jesus. And, you know, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but one of the main things that they began to see was is that there was power in the name of Jesus. In Luke chapter 10, verse 2, Jesus said this to them, "The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Pray you, therefore, the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest." In other words, God is looking for somebody that's willing to labor in the field. He's looking for some people because the harvest is plenteous. You know, the Word of God teaches time and again about the harvest time in the Old Testament, a true physical harvest, but in the New Testament, a type of a harvest, a spiritual harvest, talking about the souls of man, talking about the truth that God one day is going to reap souls from this earth. Amen. He's been planting the seed of the gospel in the soil and causing it to water as the Holy Spirit has been moving upon the land and causing more and more people to come into the kingdom. But one day there's going to be a harvest.
Right.
And that's what Jesus was sending them out to tell them about. You know, sometimes whenever the Lord finally moves on our hearts to go out and to begin to tell people about the truth of the gospel, sometimes we're met with a little bit of rejection. I don't know if you've ever experienced that before, but Jesus warned them in Luke chapter 10, verse 16, the verse right before we started, he said this. He says, "He that hears you, hears me. And he that despises you, despises me. And he that despises me, despises him that sent me."
Wow.
You know, there's going to be people that are going to despise the true gospel of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
If you never experienced that yet, I can assure you, if you serve the Lord for any length of time and you try to tell people about the Lord or you try to tell people about what God's done in your life, you're going to experience that.
Yes.
And you know, we're still living in the same age that was taking place whenever Jesus was inaugurating something called the church age. In other words, when Jesus came here and the Spirit of God was resident in him and that message of the gospel began to go forth, the message of the harvest began to go forth, you and I still live in that time frame known as the church age. And the church age, this is the call of the life of the believer. We're instructed by God to go in his power and to let the lost of this fallen world know that God has established his kingdom on earth in Jesus, and that the day is coming when this kingdom will one day be fulfilled. Now look, when they returned to Jesus, they were really excited. You saw that, right? They were amazed at the fact that the forces of evil were subject to them. In other words, they had journeyed in the name of Jesus. They saw the power of God. They experienced that the power of God was more powerful than even the forces of evil. There was at least three different statements that we read in verse 17. They said, "Even the devils are subject unto us through your name." In verse 18, Jesus said this. He said, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." You know, I've often thought of that scripture, and there may be differing people that question exactly what that means. But in my personal opinion, what that scripture is talking about is the pre-incarnate word, which was Jesus. What are you talking about? What does that fancy word mean? It means that there was a time when Jesus was the word that was with the Father that spoke the world into existence. And then that word became flesh and dwelt on earth. And what I'm trying to say is that I believe that whenever Jesus in that position of deity, he viewed in heaven when Satan attempted to elevate himself above the throne of God and the power of God expelled him from heaven. Jesus knows that the power of God is more powerful than the power of the forces of evil. Amen. He goes on to another spot. They said, "I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy." Jesus likens demon spirits to scorpions and serpents. But the main point is this, is that Jesus says that "I've given you," his disciples, "power over demon spirits." Amen.
Amen.
Look at 1 Corinthians 1:18, because right now we're talking about the power of God. Because listen, the Word of God says that he's asking his disciples to stand up and to go forth to be a laborer in the field and to let other people know about the good news of Jesus Christ. You're not going to accomplish that in your own strength. You need the power of God behind you. There's power in the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 1:18 says this, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." Now, I don't know what other people have taught you before about regarding the power of God. But I'm here to tell you that the Word of God says the power of God is connected to the message. That's really what the word preaching there is, logos, the message of the cross. The story of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. From the beginning with the fall of man, God already, and I don't want to get ahead of myself, began to bring forth the plan of God, which would ultimately result in Jesus showing up on the face of the earth, the sinless one who would offer Himself as a sacrifice to pay the penalty of sin. It may not make sense to the logical mind, but I'm here to tell you that in that message is where the power of God resides. And if you and I could get a revelation of that, the preacher can get up here and he can preach till he's red in the face and veins pop out in his forehead. And sometimes I do that because I get real excited about the Word of God. But the reality of it is that I can't convince you of it. I can't speak it eloquently enough. It has to be a revelation from the Holy Spirit that would prove to you that what I'm telling you is true, that it's what Jesus did and what He did alone that allows you to gain access to the power of God, to hallelujah, to where even the demon spirits would obey because of the power that's resident in the name of Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but I need the power of God working in my life. I need power over demon spirits. I need power over the forces of evil. If Jesus isn't the center of my earth, I'm going to be like a top that spins out of control. Yes. All wobbly and falling off the table.
Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. All messed up. All jacked up. Everything falling apart all around me. Come on, somebody. Yes. I need Jesus as the center. I don't want to be ashamed of the name of Jesus.
Right.
Yes. I don't care if people look at me like
right.
I'm crazy.
Amen.
I'm convinced that He's real. I'm convinced that He has a plan. Have you been born again? If you've been born again and the Holy Spirit has come to live on the inside of your heart, then you're probably on my team. You might not be as loud as me. You might not be as passionate about it as I am. But you know as well as I know that if Jesus is at the center of your earth, of your life, it's going to all go spinning out of control. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center. The preaching of the cross, the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified is the power of God.
Yes.
There's power in that message.
Yes.
Hallelujah. God's power moves behind it. Look at Colossians chapter 2, verses 14 through 15, because we're talking about the power of God. I want to explain that to you a little bit. It says right here, I like to teach also, but right here in Colossians 2, 14 through 15, it says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. What is that talking about right there? We can be conversational. We're still a small church. Amen. What does that mean? The handwriting of ordinances that was against us. The law. That's right. It's talking about the law. See, the law was contrary to you. Because the law said you shall not steal, you shall not kill, you shall not lie, you shall not want your neighbor's AMG Mercedes Benz, and you shall not want your neighbor's wife. And you shall not covet her nor his Mercedes Benz. And so even if you never did this, 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 and this, you sure enough thought about wanting one of those things. Lord help us. The ordinances of the law, the handwriting of the law was against us. Why? Because it called us guilty, because ain't nobody in this room ever kept the law to its perfection. There was only one. His name was Jesus. Hallelujah. And that was His whole purpose. To keep the law. Look, it was contrary to us. Why was it contrary? Because it called you guilty. See, the moment you walk up in a church building and you've been sitting in the pew and you think that you have arrived, you already have the wrong idea. You now have clothed yourself with self-righteousness. Instead of the righteousness of Jesus, you now perceive your own goodness compared to somebody else. You might look real good when you compare yourself to me, but when you compare yourself to Jesus, who's the plumb line, then we don't look so good. Lord, help us. I'm a sinner in need of grace. Amen. Look, the law was contrary to us. Look at this. He took it out of the way. How did he do that? He nailed it to his cross. Hallelujah. Jesus came in perfect human flesh. Hallelujah. Because he was born of the virgin. He was born of incorruptible seed. And he walked this earth. And he never once failed the Father. And he kept the law to its perfection. And then he offered himself up on the cross, paying the penalty of the law that was broken by you and I.
Yes. Good.
Look at the next verse. He says, and look at this, him having spoiled principalities and powers. I need you to know that principalities and powers right there is talking about demon spirits and fallen angels. It's talking about the forces of evil that the disciples in the passage we just read said, even they obey when we use your name. There's authority in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Look at this. He made a show of them openly triumphing over them in it. Now, many of you have been sitting in this church for quite some time now, and you already know what it is referring to. It's referring to the last, it's referring to the direct object regarding the word cross that we talked about earlier, because he took the law out of the way, he nailed it to his cross, and also through that he triumphed over principalities and powers in it. The point that I'm trying to make is that this is where the victory came from. In the Greek language, I love this, and I've told this story before, but Kenneth Weiss, the Greek scholar, says that the Apostle Paul, by using this terminology in the Greek, is talking about the fact that when he ascended on high, Jesus, when he, after he had already died on the cross, after he had resurrected from the dead, when he ascended on high, when he led captivity captive, we don't have time to go there, but you know, there were Old Testament saints. Let's just go ahead and take it. I need you to know something. You saved, they were saved the same in the Old Testament that we're saved in the New Testament. Don't let somebody lie to you. See, they were saved trusting in the blood of the sacrifice as they kept their eye waiting for Messiah to show up. You and I trust in the blood of the fulfilled sacrifice because Messiah did show up. But all, hallelujah, but the Word of God says that the blood of bulls and goats couldn't remove sin. So that means men like David and Abraham were in a place called Abraham's bosom, paradise, a holding place, waiting for the finished work of Jesus to come. And when Jesus completed his work on Calvary, don't listen to some of them Word of Faith preachers.
Come on.
Oh, I'm going to call them out. Kenneth Copeland, don't listen to that garbage. They talked about Jesus died spiritually and that he had to go to hell and that he had to confess with his mouth and become a born again, the first born again believer. That's a lie from the pit of hell.
Yeah.
I'm here to tell you that Jesus never sinned. If he had a sin, he wouldn't have resurrected from the dead. Because he had no sin, there was, death had no hold on him, and he came busting out the grave. Hallelujah. But what the Word of God is saying in the Greek language right there is that when he led captivity captive, he went down there to captivity and he brought all those that were in Abraham's bosom because the blood of bulls and goats couldn't remove their sin. But when he died, because they had been looking forward to the day that he would come, and he led captivity captive, the Bible says that he triumphed over them in it. Meaning that those demon spirits and fallen angels in the second heavens, in the spiritual realm, viewed this as though it was a parade that was being paraded through heaven. Because in the Roman Empire, whenever those Roman soldiers would conquer a land, they would take the general of the other country, they would strip him of all of his armor, strip him of all of his uniform, and then they would parade him through the town of Rome. And all the citizenry would clap and cheer, and that's what happened in the spiritual realm whenever Jesus defeated principalities and powers. Why are you so excited, preacher? Because I'm here to tell you this morning, there's a harvest, hallelujah. God's looking for laborers, but he's not expecting you to do it in your own strength. He wants to strengthen you through the power of the message of the cross, and he wants to give you what you need in order to do what he's called you to do and for me to do what he's called me to do. Thank you, Lord. Jesus has come to earth to give us power over the forces of evil. And then there's a shift in the story. Remember that? A lawyer stood up. This isn't a Morris Bart. One call, y'all. No, that's not what this is. This is a lawyer of the Mosaic law. Expert in the law of Moses. A Jewish man that understood the Jewish law. And he stands up in the crowd. And really when it says he tempted Jesus, the idea is he's putting Jesus to the test. Basically, he's saying, well, I'm an expert of the law, and I want to make sure that your doctrine holds up to the standards of the law of Moses. And he begins to ask him, how can I receive eternal life? And you heard the story. Jesus talked about the fact. He said, you got to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. He responded to Jesus. Jesus said, if you do this, then you're heading in the right direction. But what should have happened to him is the same thing that should happen to each and every one of us. We should be able to see what the law should be able to do is to convict us in our heart.
Right.
To remind us that we have not accomplished all of those things. That we have not loved God with all of our heart, our mind, our soul, and all of our strength. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm not saying we don't love God. I'm just saying that we haven't given him everything like he gave us everything, right? And that there's times in our life when we fail him. Come on, somebody. Am I the only one here? Help us out, Lord. Whenever there's times in our life when we don't do that, but ultimately, whenever we are seeking after the face of God, what happens? He causes our hearts to be right towards our neighbor, right? When I'm right with the Lord, I'm right with you. When I'm right with the Lord, I don't want to beat you down. I don't want to be ugly. I don't even want to be rude to you. I want to be sweet.
That's right.
Because Jesus is sweet.
Amen.
Jesus is kind and compassionate.
Yes.
Jesus ain't talking about you behind your back, y'all. You know what I'm saying? I mean, Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus loves people.
Yes.
Amen. Help us, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. But instead, what he did was he tried to justify himself. Remember that? He said, well, then who is my neighbor, Lord? How many times do we try to justify ourselves? I mean, I'm just being real. I don't have to use you as an example. I'll use myself as an example. Yeah, but I know I was rude, but, you know, hey, she just knew how to push that button. If anybody knew how to push it, it was her. Poof, she pushed it. Oh, well, you just got what you deserve now. It was a test in your life, and you failed, right?
Yeah.
Lord, help us. So he tried to justify himself, but what he should have done was he should have come to the revelation and the realization that he himself had failed God, and that guess what? His righteousness wasn't going to get it done. Look at what Romans chapter 3, verse 21 and 22 say about God's righteousness. I love this scripture. I talk about this scripture all the time. Just because this is one of those scriptures that back in the day when I first started reading, I didn't have a clue what it was saying. I just read over it, you know. But now that I understand it, I love it. I like to try to talk to people about it. Y'all, hope y'all aren't getting tired of it. I know I've used this scripture about 100 times.
Amen.
Look what it says right here. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifest. So this is the Apostle Paul writing a letter to the Roman church in the New Testament about AD 65, something like that. And what do you think he's saying when he says, now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested? What do you think the Apostle Paul means by that?
Christ.
He's talking about Jesus Christ. And he's going to go on and explain not just Jesus, who he was, but Jesus also what he did. But look what he goes on to say this, that without the law is manifest. See, because look, in the Old Testament, God's law showed God's righteousness. Amen? And man couldn't keep God's righteousness. But now God has sent his righteousness in visible form. That's a beautiful thing. You and I can go through the pages of the Gospels and we can see the life of Jesus and we can see how he responded to people and we can see how Jesus behaved and how Jesus responded in a righteous manner. Amen. But look at this. God without the law is manifested, but look, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. What is that talking about? Well, the law was the first five books of the Bible. The prophets included the major and the minor prophets. Isaiah, Amos, all of these Old Testament prophets. So the law, meaning the Old Testament, witnessed that Jesus was coming. Did you know that? God didn't just write this in a dark alley somewhere and expected everybody just to believe. No, the problem that we've had is we haven't opened the book and read. And the truth is that for thousands of years, God had been witnessing through the Old Testament prophets, through the law of Moses. In other words, God was doing his own preaching. God was preaching for thousands of years through the Old Testament, and he was saying, hey, he's coming. He's going to be born of a virgin. You shall call his name Emmanuel. His hands will be pierced. His feet will be pierced. He will hang on a cross. Oh, he's the seed of the woman. He's the seed of Abraham. He's the seed of Judah. He's the seed of David. He's the sacrifice in the garden. He's the sacrifice on Passover. He's the blood that was sprinkled on the mercy seat. And he's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. For thousands of years he was preaching. preaching the gospel.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Look at this. Next verse. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. Let's look at the next scripture just to see what it says. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Next scripture. Look at this. I wanted you to see that. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. You know what redemption means? It means a purchase price. It means you were born a slave. You may not like to hear that, but you were born a slave because you were born of Adam and you were born in sin. But Jesus paid a ransom price for you. He shed his precious blood. That's the currency of the kingdom, the blood of Jesus Christ. Look at the next verse. Look at this. Whom God has set forth to be a propitiation. The word means an acceptable sacrifice unto God through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. The idea that I wanted you to see, I went further because it's just such a good passage of scripture, but I just really wanted you to see that the righteousness of God is Jesus.
Yes.
No, you're not getting me. The righteousness of God is Jesus.
Yes.
It's not because you think you're better than your neighbor that's sitting next to you. It's not because you think that, oh, but I don't do what they do. That ain't gonna fly whenever you're standing in the face of the Lord. You're either covered by the blood of the Lamb or you're not. You're either in Christ or you're not. You're either born again or you're not. Hallelujah. And if you're born again, you're covered in the blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, the enemy might want to lie to you. He's going to keep on trying to whisper to you. He's going to keep on putting his old crooked claw finger and he's going to say, come on, come play with me. You remember what we did last night? You remember what we did last week? He's a liar and the father of lies. You're either in Christ or you're not. If you've been born again, you're covered with the blood of Jesus. I got to tell you, the word of God says in Colossians 2:6, the same way you received him, so shall you continue to walk in him. The way you received him is through faith in what he did for you at the cross. The way you walk in him each and every day is through faith in what he did for you at the cross. How does that work? Because when you exhibit faith in what Christ has done, God sees you as righteous. And now because you're righteous, you have access to the grace of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
The grace of God, the moving and operation of the Holy Spirit in your life.
Yes, Lord.
But that's not what he did. He didn't see himself as a failure. Instead, he wanted to justify himself. And you know, as I was studying this passage of the Good Samaritan, I think this is going to be my fastest message since we've opened the church. Y'all ready? As I was studying this passage of the Good Samaritan, I received the revelation that this parable is an illustration of the truth that we just recently read. What are you talking about, preacher? Well, the passage that we read in the first part, where the disciples are on a journey and telling others about the gospel, is depicted, in my opinion, in the parable of the Good Samaritan. I'm going to try to break it down for you. God's kingdom has come to earth. God wants the lost and hurting of the world to know his truth, and he is looking for people that he can entrust this task to. Point number one. The result of the fall of man. You know, I used to say this all the time, but I'm going to say it again. Good news starts with bad news. People are like, man, you got a negative confession. You know, no, I don't have a negative confession. I got a positive confession.
Yeah.
But the problem is that man sinned. And the result of man's sin caused all of us to be born sinners.
Yeah.
But good news, the Father has a prescription, amen, for this malady, for this infection. He wrote a prescription, and it's called Jesus Christ, amen. The scripture said a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment. I want you to see that. See this poor soul. You know, Jerusalem is about 3,000 feet in elevation, and this road that would descend and go down to Jericho was a very treacherous hike. He was going down from Jerusalem and going down in elevation, and the road winded amongst rocky terrain, and injury was common, but not only that, it also provided a place where thieves could hide. In the little rocks and the crags and the little crevices that took place along the road. And unsuspectingly, this poor man in this parable is walking down, heading to Jericho, and the thieves come out and they grab a hold of him and they leave him in this perilous situation. They took his clothing off of him and left him exposed. And he's wounded and he's half dead and he's just laying there bleeding all over the place. You know, I began to realize, no, that was me. That's Matt right there. That's Matt in his first birth in Adam. That's Matt in his life of misery before Christ. That's Matt and all of the failures and all of the mistakes that he ever made. Sneakily, hidingly, the enemy hiding in a crevice, just like he did to Adam and Eve, deceivingly, hiding the truth about sin, cloaking it and covering it up and presenting it in such a fashion that it looked pretty, that it was going to taste good, that it was going to feel good. Come on, just take one little nibble and you're going to like it. You're going to enjoy it. And the reality of it is that it left mankind in a destitute state with his raiment ripped off of him, wounded and bleeding and dying on the Jericho road.
Amen.
I have to tell you, spiritually speaking, this is the story of the fall of man. Once again, Satan deceptively hid his sin, and when man sinned in Adam, it resulted in the whole human race being spiritually wounded, left naked and left for dead. You know the word wound right there? One of the meanings behind it means to be plagued. Mankind. I remember there was a friend of Robert, a good friend of Robert's that I believe is my friend also that Robert introduced me to. Whenever we were first talking, we used to hang out a lot. And I kept, back at this time, I was using this terminology a lot. I kept saying about the infection. We were born with an infection. And I could tell he just didn't like it. He's like, see, there you go again with all that negative talk that you keep talking about this infection. I'm like, man, I got to tell you the truth, dude. We were born with an infection. It's called sin. But there's an antidote. There's a remedy. God's got an antibiotic to take care of it. Hallelujah. His name is Jesus. But that's it. We were wounded. We received a plague. There's the fall of man has caused us to be changed. The fall of man changed everything. Man, plagued with sin, found himself in a new place, so different than the place where he was before the fall.
Yeah.
How often do we talk about this? We talk about it a lot. But just remember that there was a time whenever God would spend time in the cool of the evening with Adam and Eve. And then after the fall, Adam finds himself hiding amongst the trees. Many Bible scholars believe that before the fall, now this is one thing I'll tell you whenever it's just commentary and it's just Matt's opinion and he can't prove it absolutely from the scripture, but I got a lot of evidence to back it up. So this is one of those times. Many scholars believe that before the fall, Adam and Eve would have been clothed with the glory of God. Amen. You know what I'm saying? Like they didn't know they were naked. They were clothed with the glory of God. God's presence was so close to them that their clothing was his literal presence. But when sin came in, all of a sudden, now they're exposed. They're exposed and they're left naked. And whenever this takes place, it begins a thread of theology that is woven through the pages of Scripture. A thread of theology woven through the pages of Scripture that speaks of the fact that mankind must be clothed upon. Immediately, Adam and Eve attempt to sew together fig leaves in order to make themselves apron. The works of their own hands. The attempt at man through his own works, through his own religion, through his own self-righteousness to cover himself and to hide his exposure. But God said in the garden, that's not going to work. And instead, what he did was he provided skins for them. The word of God teaches that he provided skins for them. Where did the skins come from? It had to be the first sacrifice that was ever performed, and it was God himself that performed that sacrifice. Listen, I'm not even going to tell you the name of the preacher because I don't really like the preacher that much, but when he said this, it was good. He said there was that innocent animal sitting on the side right there. That animal had never done anything wrong. It was Adam's sin. It was Eve's sin. And that animal had never done anything wrong, and there God, he made skins for them and covered them with that. And they were covered now with this innocent animal's skin and thinking to themselves, Adam had a relationship with these animals. He had named every one of these animals. Mm-hmm. And not one of them had to die in place of his sin. Mm-hmm. Lord, help us.
Yes, Lord.
God clothed them with the skins of an innocent animal, which was a type of Jesus dying on the cross for our sin. Listen, this is what the Bible teaches in the New Testament, Galatians 3:27. There's a theology, like I said, that runs through the scriptures that says man must be clothed upon. God clothed man with the skins of an animal. And it says right here that if you've been baptized into Christ, if you are now a believer in Jesus Christ, that you have put Him on. Right. Another translation says, you've clothed yourself with Christ Jesus. Look at Revelation 3:5. He that overcomes, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. White clothing. White represents purity. White represents righteousness. He says, and I will not blot out His name out of the book of life, but I will confess His name before my Father and before His angels. Hallelujah. Mankind once exposed because of his sin, then attempted with his own hands, his own works to cover up his nakedness, but God provided an animal, and now the fulfillment of that is Jesus Christ. And when you put your faith in Christ, you're now clothed upon with Jesus. When the Father looks at you, He doesn't see your failure, He doesn't see your sin, He sees the righteousness of Jesus, and ultimately one day that's going to result. Amen. He's worthy of glory, He's worthy of honor, and one day that's going to result in you being clothed with white raiment. Yes. Hallelujah. You're going to be in the presence of God. Amen. Not because of your righteousness, but because of the righteousness that was given unto you. That was point number one, the results of the fall of man. Point number two is Jesus' healing power. It says, but a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine. The healing power of Jesus. Now, I want to explain a little bit to you. So, first there was a priest that came. Now, you know, let me explain. This isn't like the kind of priest that we would be aware of. You know, these guys that walk around with white collars. We're talking about, these were descendants of Aaron. Descendants of Aaron that offered up the sacrifices in the temple. Right? And then after the priest came the Levites. Now, does anybody, y'all remember what a Levite is? Was Aaron a Levite? Yes, he was. Right? Aaron and Moses were Levites. Their sister Miriam were Levites. They came from the tribe of Levi. But all the Levites weren't necessarily from Aaron. The ones that were from Aaron were priests. The Levites helped out in the work of the temple. They would make sure that the bread was baked and replaced. They would make sure that all the utensils were taken care of. They would make sure that all of the various aspects of ministry were taken care of. So essentially what you're talking about, I'm talking about, this is a preacher walked by and saw him over there bleeding and dying on the Jericho Road, and he just kind of stayed on the other side, kept going. Then some of y'all walked by, or some of the people in the church walked by, not y'all. Y'all wouldn't do that. Some of the people in the church walked by, saw him bleeding down on the Jericho Road, but they just stayed on the other side. But what is a Samaritan? Well, we don't have time to get into it real deep, but let's just suffice it to say this, that the Jews hated Samaritans. They considered them half-breeds. They considered them hypocrites. They considered them people that didn't even understand the Bible. They would have never looked at them as quote-unquote Christians. They were outcasts. So in the physical reality of what's going on, they were people that were really no good, that they looked at and they looked down upon them. But yet at the same time, he's the one that went back and helped. That's what's going on as far as Jesus telling the parable. And what that's doing is it's basically slapping the religious leaders in the face. Because he's saying, you wouldn't have gone back and helped, and instead you walked on the other side, but this Samaritan went back and helped. That's what's happening literally right there while he's speaking. But you know what I began to see also, and I think Ross might have even preached this one time, that not only that though, that Jesus was an outcast. The Bible says that this man had compassion on him. Can I tell you that every time you look up the word compassion in the English language, it's usually referring to Jesus. He had compassion on the multitude. Multiple times the Bible talks about the fact that Jesus had compassion on the multitude. Jesus was an outcast. He came to seek and to save those who were perishing. Jesus came unto his own, but his own received him not, is what John 1:11 says. John 5:39 through 40, Jesus was talking to the religious leaders. I love this scripture. John 5:39 and 40, this is what Jesus says. He says, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they, talking about the scriptures, which testify of me, and you will not come to me that you might have life. You're sitting there and you're feverishly flipping through the pages of Scripture and you're reading them because you believe that they'll give you eternal life. He's talking to the religious folk. But yet they are trying to tell you the story of me, but whenever I show up, you reject me. So many times people, they love religion, but they don't really want to give themselves to Jesus.
Oh, come on.
Come on, somebody. Help me out. Y'all know what I'm talking about. If y'all grew up in religion, how many times did y'all really talk about Jesus? No, it was about doing through the motions.
Right.
But, oh, Lord, help me. You know, last night I was so excited when I was working on this message. I kept singing this song that I remembered. I can't sing very well. But I was grabbing my daughter's. And actually dancing with them and singing it, they thought it was so weird. Because I can't really dance, but I did it anyway. Because the more weird I thought that they thought I was, the more I did it, you know? Hallelujah. I'm going to try to sing it. I can't sing too good. But I learned a song at Twin City Gospel. And you know what I realized is this, is that whoever wrote this song already knew what I'm just now getting a revelation of. It says, he poured in the oil and the wine, the kind that restoreth my soul. He found me bleeding and dying on the Jericho road, and he poured in the oil and the wine. See, I don't know about you, but that's how Jesus found me. I was bleeding and dying on the Jericho road. My raiment had been stripped. I was wounded and had been born with a plague. But he saw me and he had compassion on me. Hallelujah. And he came over there and he ministered to me and he gave me the gospel. And when I responded by faith, new life. Oh, thank you, Lord. But what about this oil and wine? See, that's what I'm talking about. He poured in the oil and the wine. That's the title of my message. The word wine. I thought about this. Matthew 26, 27 through 28. Jesus, it says, he took the cup and gave thanks. And he gave it to them saying, drink ye all of it. Drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. See, what I want you to note this morning is I don't think it's an accident that the parable was told that he poured in the oil and the wine. And that the wine Jesus is talking about is the giving of me as myself as a sacrifice. Hallelujah. See, in the Old Testament, in these times, they would use wine to disinfect these wounds. The same way that the wine would disinfect wounds in a literal sense, then is the same truth today that the blood of Jesus cleanses, hallelujah, from all unrighteousness.
Amen.
And because of that, look, then not only did he pour in the wine, but he poured in the oil.
Spirit, hallelujah.
Hallelujah, the Spirit of God. Isaiah 61:1. Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted and to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. You know what the word anointed means? We've explained this before. The word in the New Testament means chrisma. It means to be smeared or to have oil poured upon. The word of God says in the Old Testament how beautiful it is that when brethren dwell in unity together, it's like the oil that dripped down Aaron's beard. When the priest was anointed, they pour oil on his head. When young David came in from the field in the presence of everyone in Bethlehem, they poured oil on his head. Oil is a type of the Holy Spirit. Whenever you, because of what Jesus did at the cross, it gives us access, hallelujah, to the oil of the Spirit. I'm here to tell you that proper faith in Christ allows the Holy Spirit to bring healing to your life. Oh, that's a good word right there. Because let me tell you something, you might be sick in your body. You might be sick in your emotional status. You might be sick in your soul. You might be sick in your mind. And you don't know how you're going to get well. You don't know how you're going to get healed. You're going through something. Turbulent times in your life. Turbulent times in your family. I'm here to tell you, God's got an answer.
Amen.
He poured in the oil and the wine. Hallelujah. The kind that restores my soul. Jesus can restore your soul.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit will do the work that you need done. If you'll trust Him.
Yes.
If you want it.
If you let Him.
Yes, right. If you let Him do it, He'll do it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It also says in Acts 10:38-39, the Apostle Peter was talking about how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Amen. The oil and the wine. All right, that brings me to my last point. Point number three, he's coming back one day and he will repay. Amen. Amen. The scripture says, this is the first time I ever saw this, but I was so excited when I saw this. And on the morrow, in other words, the next day when he departed, that's talking about Jesus now. Jesus is the Good Samaritan. Amen. Jesus is the one that had compassion. Jesus is the one that poured in the oil and the wine. Jesus put him on his own beast and he's bringing him to the inn. And he says when he departed, he took out 2 pence and he gave them to the host of the inn. And he said unto him, take care of him. And whatsoever you spend more, when I come again, I will repay it unto you.
Glory.
You ain't going to outspend the Lord. Yeah. You're not going to outdo God on this in this time frame known as the church age as you go doing the work of the Lord. Because let me tell you something. There comes a time in our walk with God where we go from being the man that's bleeding and dying to where we go to being the innkeeper.
Yeah.
Where God picks us up. He binds up our wounds. He pours in the oil and the wine. He begins to heal and to restore our soul. And when he does it and we look backwards and we see where he's brought us from and where he's bringing us to, oh man, all of a sudden the joy of the Lord begins to enter our heart. And we're like, man, God's been good to me. Man, God's been good to me. I got to tell somebody about it. Hallelujah. And that's what happened right here. The Lord said, hey, I'm going to entrust this with you. I'm going to entrust this man that's hurting with you. I'm going to entrust this poor soul with you. I've done a work in his life already. I've started the work in his life, but I'm going to have to trust you to take care of him. But don't you worry. Anything that you spend on this situation, I'm going to repay even more when I come back. I'm closing with this. Now you can come up to the front. We're going to play some music, but I'm closing with this concept out of Matthew chapter 25. Verses 14 through 30. I'm not even going to read it. I'm just going to talk to you a little bit about it. But if you're taking notes, you can write it down. It's called the parable of the talents. The Bible says in the parable of the talents that there was a good man. That there was a... For the kingdom of heaven... This is what Jesus said. Let me just explain this part to you. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling to a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. A man, the kingdom of God is likened unto a man that's traveling to a far country. Jesus became a man and walked upon this earth. He died on the cross. He resurrected from the dead. He ascended to the Father. Jesus went to a far country. He told Philip, he said, if it wasn't so, I wouldn't tell you, I'm going to my house to prepare a place for you.
Yes.
And if I'm going away, I will come back again. Jesus is coming back again. This story tells the fact that he gave one man 5 talents. He gave another man 2 talents. He gave another man 1. Talent was a form of money. And what the Bible teaches that one day he came back again. One day he came back again to settle accounts with his servants. He gave to each one of them based upon what he knew they could accomplish. Jesus is never going to ask anything of you that he has not equipped you for.
That's right. Amen.
I remember whenever Robert and I first started hanging around, Robert kept saying, man, I could see it in his own life. He was on fire for the Lord. He was on fire for the Lord, man. He could witness to anybody one-on-one at the drop of a hat. He'd lay hands on people and pray for them. But everybody wanted to make him a preacher. And I remember he kept saying, I don't feel like the Lord's called me to be a preacher, but everybody wants to make him a preacher because he was over here being a witness. Just because we've called to be a witness doesn't mean that we're all called to be a preacher to stand behind a pulpit.
Amen.
But God gave Robert a certain amount of talents. God gave me a certain amount of talents. God's given you a certain amount of talents. And when he comes back to collect, he's just expecting you to have done what he gave you that he called you to do with what he gave you.
Amen.
Amen. He's wanting you not to be like the unfaithful servant who didn't do what he was supposed to do with what was given to him. And like this innkeeper, that's who you and I are. Amen? Maybe we're at different places in our walk. As she plays this song, I just want to encourage you that if you need prayer for anything, amen? If you feel like you're the man on the Jericho Road and you're bleeding and you're dying and you need God to move in and to bring healing, listen, come forward, we'll pray for you. If you feel like you're having trouble walking it out with the Lord, if you feel like you need the power of God moving in your life to strengthen you and to encourage you so that you can be like the innkeeper and be entrusted with those that God sends your way, come forward and we'll pray with you. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.